We were lost, me and my sister. It was our first trip to Germany from India. And after 15-20 minutes of sightseeing in the city, we were lost. What had happened 10 minutes back was that I told my father, we are really enjoying our trip and we would want to click more pictures. So can you please move a little ahead and faster, and we would keep seeing you and following you. But after what happened was really not good. After 10 minutes, I looked around for my parents and I could not find it. I could not find them. My sister was almost in tears. As teenagers, we were lost in a country where we did not even know the local language. At that point in time, I closed my eyes and I prayed from God, God, please show me the way. I opened my eyes and I did not find God. There was nobody to assist and tell me what was the way. So I found some courage and I went around and asked people if they understand English. And after meeting two or three people, I figured out one person understood some bits of English, and I requested them, can you please give me your phone? I need to call my parents and tell them that we are here. They left us probably a kilometer behind them. And he gave us the phone, thankfully. I called my father. He came to pick us up, and obviously he was angry. I promised him I will follow him, but I did not. Some time went by and we matured, and then I was on a trip in New Zealand. And there I was, and I found a beautiful location. We were driving and suddenly we realized we are lost. This time I was with my husband, and I could not find a human soul around, even for kilometers on my right or on my left, and there were mountains otherwise. So who should I have asked? Where should I go? This time I did not close my eyes and say, God, please tell me where to go. Instead, I opened up my phone and I asked Google, Google, where should I go? And you won't believe, Google actually told me the way. And we were right on the road after a few minutes. I wish I can be lost in a beautiful setting like this again, but it hasn't really happened again. At that point in time, I really thought Google came close to God for me in 10 years. How it happened, I wanted to understand. And for that reason, I started looking for secrets behind Google's growth. So I wanted to know what led the company that it became so close to being God for me. I found this man. He's the ex-CEO of Google who served as Google CEO for 10 years. He's Mr. Eric Schmidt. He's an inspiration for me in every way I can actually say. And whenever I see him in this pose, like this, I know something is happening at Google. I know something is really coming up which will change our lives for good. And while I was really reading about him, understanding what he does, how he does, I came to know of the secret formula. Do you want to know the formula? Great, I would tell you that today. The secret wasn't in what exactly he was doing on the server or in the technology, but the secret was found in his Monday meetings. Every Monday for almost a decade, he would start his team meeting at 1 p.m. sharp. 1 p.m. means 1 p.m. for him. That's how executives run big companies like Google. And the moment he would enter the boardroom or the meeting room where people would be sitting, including executives from all over the world or executives who are very important in his meeting, he would say, so how was your weekend? Tell me about it. And if you traveled, tell me in detail about it. What he was really stressing on was not operations, not agendas, not technical problem solving, not troubleshooting for manpower, but the meeting would start from trip diaries or informal trip reports given by every executive who was there in the meeting. Why was he giving so much importance to trip diaries and travels? Why informal travel report took so much time of a meeting where people were really, really influential and inspiring and were there to do a big job? I wanted to figure that out. And you know what used to happen? People used to ask him, okay, Eric, we have told you our stories. You tell your story now. And at that point in time, he would put a screen up, he would put Google Map on the screen, he would drop Google pins on the locations he had been to, and he would start telling tales and what exactly he observed. He was really enjoying his discussion, and all the team members were also enjoying the discussion about travels and the trip diaries. But why was he spending so much time? I really wanted to know about that. So I started the research. What I really found was this. On Google, yes, again, I went to Google. I searched why traveling is so important. And I found that travel makes you smarter. So what Eric was really doing, he was making his team really smart by advocating traveling and by encouraging people to travel so that every Monday when they come up, they should have something to talk about. I Googled again. I found another reason to travel. Harvard Business Review says that there are mental benefits of traveling and vacationing somewhere new. So he was really taking care of his team members by telling them, please travel, so that while they're really doing such a big task of running Google and managing Google, they were taking care of their health, they were taking care of their emotions, and they were relaxed. Also, travel makes you more creative. So he was ensuring that the problems that were coming to his team were really solved in a creative manner. He was really doing his job very, very well, and I was very happy knowing all this. But I thought there has to be something else about travel which I'm missing. So I figured out this small study, which said, travel makes you clearer about yourself. It increases your self-concept clarity. And I then started wondering, does it really do that? And from my experience of filling up 3 full passports, yes, thanks to Indian government, they haven't really given a condition that you can't have many passports. I've already filled 3 passports. I travel with the 4th one right now with 30 plus countries and probably hundreds of trips, which I have stopped counting. I realized I had changed a lot. I had found myself. I had really realized who I was, what I wanted to become, what I was doing, and what I wanted to change. So travel was definitely bringing self-concept clarity in me. But then I thought, this couldn't be the end of travel benefits. If Google is growing so fast and exponentially, there has to be a hidden secret. So like in the picture that you can see, there were books on the shelf, like the research I told you, which you could find on the Google itself. And there was a hidden door, which would lead me to the number one reason why Google was growing and why traveling was helping the executives. I found the reason. It was this. Travel allows people to create their own interpretation of world and world events. So they can look at opportunities around from a new lens. The word here is opportunities. Now it was a heavy sentence and I really wanted to make sure that I understand it better and I know who taught this to Google. And I found this man. His name is Bill Campbell and he's the coach to CEO Eric Schmidt. He's also the coach to all the names you can possibly think of in Silicon Valley, including Steve Jobs and many others. He's the coach who has actually helped so many executives run big companies smooth and seamlessly. And if you have to ask me why CEO need coach or why executives and founders of big Silicon Valley companies need coach, that's a big story and that's for some other day. But I am truly inspired by this gentleman and he was the one who inspired that communication approach of bringing trip reports and travel summaries into the Monday 1 p.m. meetings of Eric Schmidt. And one of the meetings between Eric and Bill, he actually figured out that he had done a one-day trip to Japan from US, and that was very impressive for Eric. And I think that was the beginning of why Eric started thinking that traveling was so important. And soon, he actually approached his meetings in a way that trip summaries, trip diaries, informal trip reports became an integral part of how he convened his meetings. But what do you mean by new interpretations of old realities or world and world events? I wanted to solve that and know how Google was really doing it. For that, I figured out some stories behind this movie. Have you seen this movie? Very good. This was a movie which actually won 8 out of 10 Oscar nominations, which it had. And it had put India on a limelight like nothing else. Whenever I traveled around the release of this movie, in any part of the world, people would talk about Slumdog Millionaire and people would talk about India. But you know what they would talk about? They would talk about the slums in India, the way it was shown in the movie. They would talk about poor sanitation in India, the way it was shown in the movie. They would talk about the poor people there, and they would be concerned how they would lead their life and how these kids will grow up to be. And a lot of them had actually gone to India and made it an international tourist spot. So now, slums in India, especially in Mumbai, are an international tourist spot. So people would come there, click pictures, and say, hey, we went to the Slumdog Millionaire site. But there were some more people who would actually say that, let's see something else there. Was it only the things that were shown in the movie, the reality of those slums? They wanted to know. And those were the people who clicked these pictures. These are the pictures from the same slums where you see hardworking people really working day and night. These are the pictures from the same slums where you see shops where people actually sell products in a very, very good way. These are the pictures of the same slum where even when the sun sets, people are actually working behind those shabby curtains. And these are the pictures of the same slums where proper shops have come up. And then when I was traveling, I started asking people, do you think there would be business running in those slums? And they would say, yeah, there should be. How will those poor people survive? And then I asked a few people, how much business do you think the same slums could do? Somebody will say a few $1,000. Somebody would say a few $100. Somebody would say $1,000,000. And I was like, wow, can you really say $1,000,000 of business happens in a year in a slum? You know what is the reality? This is the amount of business that happens in those slums. $1 billion every single year. Yes, the businesses that are run there, the businessmen who are running those shows are way more intelligent than you can ever think of. And that's why I say the future of those slums is way brighter than what was really shown in the movie. And Indians are smart too. And that was the reason why a student from IIT in Mumbai actually figured out a physical web that he could create online where all these businesses could use intelligent Internet of Things and grow their business even further. And for that reason, once he created the entire physical web, he wanted some funding. He wanted money so that he could actually research and figure out better solution for these businesses. Who really looks for businesses and serves them? You know who? Google. And that was the reason why Google was the company which actually came up and funded this project. The Google Internet of Things Technology Research Reward was given to this project to be done in the same slums where people thought nothing is possible or the future is not bright. Now I knew why people and executives in Eric Schmidt's meetings were asked to travel. They were asked to travel so that they can see the locations, the places people see, but they can see it from a different lens. They could see it from the opportunity angle, and they could see it in a way that the moment the opportunities like these come on board, they could take a decision like this, rather than saying, okay, somebody from our company will go and look at the site and then come back and tell you if at all I can refund the project or not. All the executives were trained in that culture, and all the people, even till the lowest level in Google, were trained in that culture. Look for opportunities when you travel. So this lens, which we really use for the camera, either we can use a lens which Google uses to see opportunities from a different angle, to see locations from a different angle, or ordinary lens and see Mumbai slums as just slums where nothing is thriving, no business is possible. And because Google executives only focused on Google's growth, only focused on business and opportunities, that was the reason business grew so much. And Google came so close to be like God for me. Now you would know why Monday meetings at 1 p.m. Eric Schmidt would ask, so if you traveled, tell me about it. Tell me about your travel diaries. Tell me about your informal trip reports. Why he would share his own trip summaries and observations that he made in those trips. Now you know why Bill Campbell advocated that executive CEOs must travel and travel as much as possible, even if it takes to travel long distances for a one-day trip the way he did it. And now you know why Eric Schmidt and his team actually took that culture of traveling for executives and for team members into the entire DNA of Google. So today, I want to ask you a question. When you take your next trip, what do you want to do? Do you want to see the world from the same lens as you had been seeing always? Or do you want to see the lens from the business growth lens, the way Google executives used to do? Thank you so much.